J-Ray 501 here. I'm in the American Meteor Society. And trying to get a little education here on some meteor facts. And so there's some questions and answers here. What is the difference between a meteor, a meteorite, and a meteoroid? Meteoroids are the smallest members of the solar system, ranging in size from large fragments of asteroids or comets to extremely small micrometeoroids. Whenever a meteoroid plows into the Earth's atmosphere, it will create a brief flash of moving light in the sky, called a meteor. Meteors were once thought to be purely atmospheric phenomena, and the study of these and other atmospheric effects, especially weather, spawned the science of meteorology. If remnants of the parent meteoroid survive the trip through the atmosphere to reach the ground, then these remnants are called meteorites. They have a show now I love to watch, Meteorite Men. Oh, it's cool. You haven't seen it. How high up do meteors occur? Most meteors occur in the region of the atmosphere called the thermosphere. This meteoric region lies between about 80 kilometers and 120 kilometers, or 50 to 75 miles in altitude. This is a general guideline only, since very fast meteors may first become visible above this height, and slow, bright meteors may penetrate below this band. How big are most meteoroids, and how fast do they travel? The majority of visible meteors are caused by particles ranging in size from about that of a small pebble down to a grain of sand, and generally weigh less than 1 to 2 grams. Those of asteroid origin can be composed of dense, stony, or metallic material, which is the minority, while those of cometary origin, the majority, have low densities and are composed of a fluffy conglomerate of material frequently called a dust ball. The brilliant flash of light from a meteor is not caused so much by the meteoroid's mass, but by its high level of kinetic energy as it collides with the atmosphere. Meteors enter the atmosphere at speeds ranging from 11 kilometers a second, or 25,000 miles per hour, to 72 kilometers a second, or 160,000 miles per hour. When the meteoroid collides with air molecules, its high level of kinetic energy rapidly ionizes and excites a long, thin column of atmospheric atoms along the meteoroid's path, creating a flash of light visible from the ground below. This column, or meteor trail, is usually less than 1 meter in diameter, but will be tens of kilometers long. The wide range in meteoroid speeds is caused partly by the fact that the Earth itself is traveling at about 30 kilometers a second, 67,000 miles per hour, as it revolves around the Sun. On the evening side, or the trailing edge of the Earth, meteoroids must catch up to the Earth's atmosphere to cause a meteor and tend to be slow. On the morning side, or the leading edge of Earth, meteoroids can collide head-on with the atmosphere and tend to be fast. How many meteors can I expect to see if I go out to observe for them when no meteor shower is occurring? Well, they're saying that there's an awful lot of factors involved, including the time of night, time of year, light pollution, cloud conditions. Perhaps the most important factors necessary in order to observe meteors are to have a clear, unobstructed view out in the open and under as dark sky conditions as possible. What is a meteor shower? Does it occur all at once or over a period of time? Most meteor showers have their origins with comets. Each time a comet swings by the sun, it produces copious amounts of meteoroid-sized particles, which will eventually spread out along the entire orbit of the comet to form a meteoroid stream. If the Earth's orbit and the comet's orbit intersect at some point, then the Earth will pass through this stream for a few days at roughly the same time each year, encountering a meteor shower. The only major shower clearly shown to be non-cometary is the Geminid shower, which share an orbit with the asteroid 3200 Phaethon, one that comes usually close to the Sun as well as passing through the Earth's orbit. Most shower meteoroids appear to be fluffy, but the Geminids are much more durable, as might be expected from asteroid fragments. Because meteor shower particles are all traveling in parallel paths at the same velocity, they will all appear to radiate from a single point in the sky to an observer below. This radiant point is caused by the effect of perspective. The Perseid meteor shower, peaking about August 12th, will appear to radiate from the constellation of Perseus, while the Leonid meteor shower, peaking around November 18th, will appear to radiate from the constellation Leo. Meteor shower rates are highly variable, with the number of shower meteors seen following a curve of activity, which usually lasts several days. Meteor streams also vary greatly in strength between each other, depending on such factors as the stream age, the parent body composition, stream particle density and distribution, and how close the Earth approaches to the stream core. How can I find out when a meteor shower is occurring? Well, we all know that we're all pretty hip on where to go look. The internet is filled with stuff. And this site that I'm on right now is actually an excellent, excellent site, because they actually have it broken down into weeks of the month. It's all broken down for you. So I will leave the links here, and you can come in here and take a look. Let's see. In order to successfully observe a meteor shower, some familiarity with the night sky is usually required, including the use of star charts to locate constellations and locations on the celestial sphere using the right ascension, the declination coordinate system. Plan your observing session as close to the time of the shower maximum as possible. Meteor showers are usually quite disappointing under city and suburban conditions, so a dark observation site far from city lights is preferred. Similarly, meteor showers which occur near the time of gibbous or full moon usually do not perform well. Many meteor shower radiants do not rise before midnight, making most meteor showers best between midnight and morning twilight. Okay, so if you're real serious, set your clock for 3 a.m. and get up and spend a couple of hours out looking at the show, the light show. Okay, I think that just about does it on this one. There is more information in here, and come on in and take a look, and thanks for viewing, and as always, God bless.